Hello everyone. Today we'll be discussing the diagnostic criteria of heart failure. We would like to note that the creators of this video are not healthcare professionals and that the purpose of this video is just to discuss non-individualized information regarding heart failure. Self-diagnosis should not be made based on the information in this video, and a healthcare professional should be consulted instead.
Heart failure, or sometimes referred to as congestive heart failure, is a clinical syndrome in which the heart is unable to pump blood effectively, thus leading to reduced cardiac output. It can also result in an increased risk of pulmonary congestion or swelling of limbs at rest or with stress, which is caused by the backing up of blood in the circulation. This can result in the buildup of fluid in the lungs, which can make it difficult for the person to breathe, as well as a buildup of fluid in the arms and legs. Heart failure is typically focused on patients with left ventricular system dysfunction of the heart. Now, there is an increase in awareness of the syndrome in patients with acute and chronic heart failure, right-sided heart failure, and heart failure based on the function of the ventricles and valves. This leads to the classification of heart failure types. First is chronic heart failure, which is the preferred terminology for the syndrome based on the disease's progressive nature. Next is acute heart failure, which describes rapid changes in symptoms of heart failure leading to immediate and urgent medical attention. Lastly is advanced heart failure, which is when the most severe stage is reached and therapies are no longer working to manage symptoms. Severity of these symptoms is classified based on four stages from the New York Heart Association functional classification. Class 1 is when they show no symptoms of heart failure. Class 2 is when they show mild symptoms but can still perform regular activities. Class 3 is when they present moderate symptoms leading to performance of fewer regular activities. And class 4 is when they present severe symptoms at rest with minimal activity.
Heart failure can be challenging to diagnose because symptoms may be similar to those experienced in other health conditions. Sometimes multiple diagnostic tests can be utilized to provide a greater accurate diagnosis. There are many conventional diagnostic tools to detect heart failure. This includes an ECG, a stress test, a chest X-ray, an echocardiogram, and a coronary angiogram. An ECG is used to measure the electrical signals of the heart. It can detect unusual heart rhythms, narrowed or blocked arteries, any history of a heart attack, and lastly, it can detect the efficacy of any current heart treatments. A stress test records a patient's heart health during physical activity. Thus, it is required that the patient participates in some form of physical activity during the evaluation. This can include walking, on a treadmill, or even riding a stationary bike. During the examination, the patient has electrodes and a blood pressure cuff attached to them so that their breathing, blood pressure, and heart rhythm can be recorded. A chest X-ray takes an image of the heart, lungs, blood vessels, surrounding bones, and surrounding air and fluid in the lungs. An echocardiogram is an ultrasound that also produces an image of the heart, except it uses sound waves instead of radiation. This is an important test that can detect any structural abnormalities, pressure differences within chambers, and any blood movement throughout the heart. And lastly, a coronary angiogram utilizes an X-ray image of the heart and dye to visualize the arteries that display the patient's blood flow and possible arterial narrowing.
The use of newer diagnostic tools to detect heart failure, such as natriuretic peptide levels in the blood, have recently been integrated into practice. Natriuretic peptides are hormones that circulate in the blood that work to increase renal excretion of sodium and cause vasodilation, ultimately acting to reduce total blood volume and thus regulate blood pressure. Brain natriuretic peptide, or BNP, is released specifically from the ventricles of the heart when stretch is detected, which signals that there's too much fluid in the heart. In healthy individuals, these hormones work well and lead to their desired physiological effects. However, in heart failure patients, these hormones are not as effective due to underlying dysfunction as a result of heart failure itself. Therefore, there are elevated concentrations of these hormones in the body in this clinical population, as the hormones do not produce the desired effect. So the body continues to release more to try and compensate for the lack of effect seen. BNP, as well as N-terminal fragment prohormone B-type natriuretic peptide, or NT-proBNP, are both markers that have extended bioavailability and can be accurately measured in blood tests, compared to other natriuretic peptides with shorter half-lives. These two markers also have greater clinical significance because they are released directly from the ventricles of the heart. Thus, they provide an accurate measure of the degree of impact on the heart itself during heart failure. These biomarkers have been shown to have high pooled sensitivity and a low pooled negative likelihood ratio, meaning that concentrations of BNP and NT-proBNP within appropriate cutoffs can accurately rule out the presence of heart failure with a high degree of confidence. As of 2017, Canadian guidelines recommend a threshold of 50 picograms per milliliter for BNP and 125 picograms per milliliter for NT-proBNP, where values lower than these cutoffs mean that the patient likely does not have heart failure, and values higher than these cutoffs could be indicative of heart failure. We have asked local Canadian cardiologist and associate clinical professor at McMaster University, Dr. Gregory Curnew, to speak about how he uses these markers in his practice.
Hi, my name is Gregory Curnew. I'm a practicing cardiologist and proBNP or BNP. BNP, brain natriuretic polypeptide, was discovered in the brain, but it's really actually a hormone of the heart. When the heart gets stretched, either by pressure or volume, it goes up. You can see different levels and different studies, and it's become a way of determining whether you not have congestive heart failure, where the heart is having trouble pumping or it's working at a higher pressure. Also calls severity of the disease as well. People get short breath for all sorts of reasons. I can have them just deconditioning, I'm anemic, I'm depressed, I'm chronic renal insufficiency, I have underlying lung disease, I have asthma, and I have heart failure, or a combination of the above. So historically, we define heart failure with a poor pump, and that's when actually proBNPs are the highest levels. But we also know that people who have a stiff heart or heart breaking at higher pressure, the BNP or proBNP goes up, but it's not as high. And that's clues to that the heart's being working too hard. And so I think it's been a really integral part of my practice. Sometimes you know the diagnosis, and sometimes you don't know the diagnosis, and sometimes there's multiple reasons. So BNP or proBNP are wonderful. This is actually one little study here that talks about there's two determinations, and you can be acutely short of breath, which is really that you're just suddenly getting into trouble, and the value goes up very high, usually well over 1,000, 2,000 sometimes. Or you can be chronically short of breath, and the values go somewhere above 125. In normal healthy young persons, probably less than 30 or so. So this gives you a clue. Now it's also confusing because lots of things make it go up or up or down. As you get older, the value goes up. If your kidneys aren't working, it goes up. If you're in atrial fibrillation or your heartbeat, it goes up. If you're overweight, actually goes down. So you have to put that into context. And so there's no one size fits all, but it's really become a marker for bad prognosis, such as death, if it's very high. Values over 1,000 to 2,000 make me very nervous. Values that are mildly increased can be more attentive to the heart. And that way, we can lead to a diagnosis of why you're short of breath. I hope that's helpful.
The Ontario Ministry of Health is currently running a pilot project to test for NT-proBNP levels at any community laboratory. This means that any test included within this project is funded by the government. The project is inspired by research that shows NT-proBNP and BNP levels to be a positive and confident biomarker for heart failure risk, and is also strongly supported by the Ontario Association of Cardiologists. Recent scientific studies demonstrate that NT-proBNP tests are very sensitive and can accurately rule out heart failure in suspected patients. Based on the first phase of data from this pilot, it was found that BNP and NT-proBNP were highly likely to be cost-effective in Ontario in the emergency department setting, and NT-proBNP was highly likely to be cost-effective in the community care setting. Thus, clinicians are encouraged to continue to use these tests in their practice.
Thanks for watching. Don't forget to like this video and subscribe to the Demystifying Medicine McMaster YouTube channel.